do. Jeff, why don't you introduce yourself?
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Chart Chat. My name is Jeff Shaffer. I'm the Chief Operating Officer and Vice President of Information Technology and Analytics at Unifund in Cincinnati, Ohio, on a beautiful spring day today. I'm also the Adjunct Professor of Data Visualization at, somebody's saying, not hearing Jeff at all.
I can hear you just fine. If someone could use the chat window and let us know if we can. Okay, so Sarah. Okay.
Excellent.
Thank you all.
Very good. Just testing to make sure everybody can hear me. Adjunct professor at the University of Cincinnati teaching data visualization and co-author with Steve on the Big Book of Dashboards.
Jeff, thanks so much. So I am Steve Wexler. I am the founder and principal and sole employee of Data Revelations. I was Tableau's inaugural Iron Viz champion. That was a very long time ago. I'm a five-time Tableau Zen master, and I'm certainly proud of those accomplishments within the data visualization field. But the thing I am most proud of is collaborating with Jeff and Andy on the Big Book of Dashboards. And so we advertised this thing as two data visualization experts duking it out. And I guess that's because, in fact, the two of us are just going to be kind of chatting affably, but somehow this doesn't quite have the same gravitas or excitement that something like this has. And gee, we want to have a real smackdown or disagreements here. It would make no for sure, there were lots of disagreements and debates, and that what makes for much better visualizations, as we're going to find out. So maybe this is a little dishonest because it's not really going to be a smackdown. Jeff suggested this has two guys fighting over a donut chart. It's more accurate, it isn't quite as painful, and we get the delightful awe factor coming in on this. In any case, the goal of all of this was of Chart Chat was to try to recapture the debates, the discussions that we had in writing the Big Book of Dashboards, because they were by far for me, and I think I'm speaking for Jeff and Andy, the most enthralling parts of the book, and it led for me being much, much better at data visualization, getting feedback from other people, getting pushback, getting people challenging things. So we're going to try to do that, and it looks like we probably go about once a month with this. So without further ado, I'm going to get into some of the stuff that we want to discuss with you today. And the first thing is I want to look at one of the things Jeff covered, which was a re-rendering or redoing of the famous Florence Nightingale visualization from the mid-19th century, and that a Dr. Louis had done some analysis of this and had come up with this way to re-visualize the data, which is saying over time, they were trying to figure out why are so many people dying in this allegedly a haven for soldiers who were ill, and people were coming in, they weren't getting better, they were in fact dying. And that first chart that you saw was an attempt to show what was going on, and here's a re-rendering of it and saying that when they started to improve sanitary conditions there, the deaths per thousand people dropped significantly. And Jeff decided to wanted to recast this chart, and I think it's a great redo of this. But initially, I had a little trouble with it. You know, specifically, I didn't see that there were dates at the bottom, and when I saw the length of the bars and I saw the width of these things, I thought there was some sort of Merrimako type of thing going on. And then Jeff quickly pointed out, oh no, I'm showing time. And in fact, the time intervals are not consistent here. Now, kind of with any time I see a chart that anybody does, but certainly the things that were done for the Big Book of Dashboards, I would look at, hey, is this how I would do it? Is this the best way to do it? Let me see what happens. Let me start experimenting with this. And I did. First thing I wanted to look at and said, well, why not just do this as a line chart? So here is the same data rendered as a line chart. And I put some an annotation layer there to explain some of the key things that were going on. Then I started looking at this and going, gee, this doesn't really have the heft or the visceral feel that I got from Jeff's chart with this. This is a fine chart. It's a timeline, and it works, and it presents the information. And so I started exploring other things. Now I tried doing an area chart with this. And I started going down a path and going, gee, I really like what Jeff had done. The left side had shown when the deaths per thousand were really high was one color. And then when they started putting the sanitary improvements was another color. And I started having to fight my tool of choice, which is Tableau. And I realized, hey, I could have gotten that. I did one other thing, which was I kind of looked at Jeff's bar charts and realized, oh, why not just do a step line type of thing? And you can see the peaks and valleys of this thing and what was happening. And it follows the contour of what Jeff had. But again, it didn't have the visceral appeal to it, or it didn't have the wallop that I was getting from Jeff's. I would consider this a perfectly fine chart. And as I started looking at this thing and thinking, well, what would I need to do to have that same type of emotional appeal? What I like so much about Jeff's is it's both analytically spot on, and it has a certain emotional component to it. And I decided, you know, I don't think I'm going to get something that's as good. You know, I could, you know, play or fight with the tool for another 2-3 hours. So ultimately, I realized, you know what? I think this is the best way to present it, or I don't think I can do better. You know, we can get into quibbles about the annotation layers and the font and things like that, but I think Jeff did a really good job of presenting the data. So in the book, this kind of parallels what we would do in the book. We'd present this as our solution, but we would show the other options saying, hey, here's what they have in it. Maybe this will work. Maybe it's easier to render in your tool. Because the first thing I did when I downloaded this, I looked in and I said, oh, you know, Jeff has some fancy table calculations in here. Is there a way to render this without the fancy table calculations? And I don't think I, using simple techniques, could do as effectively. So I really like this. Jeff, you have any thoughts?
Yeah, I think the thing I'm missing on the line chart, lines are great for showing trends over time, but the thing I'm missing on the line chart is the different time periods. It's really hard to see. You can kind of see it at the end when it flattens out. I guess that's an interesting piece. I mean, the calculations that Florence Nightingale did and the professor who redesigned his version are pretty complex calculations to get that sort of annual rate calculated in those individual time periods. But I missed that on the line chart, and I like that about the bar version of it.
Yeah, Jeff, you know, yesterday you had mentioned that, and I didn't even catch that. It looks like these periods are equally spaced. So
I don't know which somebody caught a typo on. I don't remember a typo in my version, but maybe the screenshot capture that you took, or did you take it off of Tableau Public, my version?
Yeah, I may have
spelled wrong on Tableau Public. Thanks, Rebecca.
Okay, Rebecca, you get 5 screaming cat buttons from us. Just give us your address. We'll send them in the mail to you. Jeff, you had given me the idea of, hey, maybe if I put these lines in, I'll be able to see that the distance between the lines aren't the same. Sorry about that. So I thought of doing that, and I still just don't think it does an effective job as your chart. So I did have fun going down the rabbit hole, though, so thanks for sending me there. Next up is some thoughts on lollipop charts. I've become a big fan of these, and for reasons that I will explain in a moment, I feel quite a bit... I feel better about endorsing them, and I'll explain why. So let me explain what I mean by a lollipop chart. Here is a typical bar chart, and people it's a wonderful way to render the data because humans are very good at comparing the length of bars with a common baseline. It is why you will see so many bar charts, but they take a lot of quote-unquote ink, not that people are necessarily printing these things, and they tend to look a little heavy, and there seems to be this, oh, I've got to create something that looks a little more interesting, and usually you've run into bad problems with that because you end up compromising the analysis, the visual integrity of your data visualization. So something that we've recommended is, well, do something like this, create a lollipop chart. And I think Andy Cotgreave was one of the first people to coin this term. Call it a lollipop because you see the stick and you see the little candy portion on the end of it. And for those of you wondering how to do this in your favorite tool, you can probably just type in lollipop chart and name of the tool in Tableau. You can certainly do that and you'll find lots of instructions. It's just a dual axes chart. It's a circle chart with a bar chart, and the bar is just very narrow. And so we mentioned this in the book, in the big book of dashboards, and saying, hey, this could be a pretty good compromise for you. And one of our favorite authors, and someone that Jeff and I know Andy have a lot of respect for, kind of took us to task with this. We were a little disappointed. Stephen Few, when, you know, privately, was kind of praising the big book of dashboards, but publicly he was kind of bashing our recommendation of using jitter plots and the lollipop chart. And so, by the way, here's a side-by-side comparison. You can see what these things do look like. But here is something from the Perceptual Edge, a blog post from about a year and a half ago. And his complaint about this was that the circle creates a modicum of imprecision because you don't know, am I supposed to be comparing the beginning of the circle, the center of the circle, or the end of the circle? Well, and none of us thought, gee, this was such a big deal. Is it really adding that greater degree of imprecision? And you could certainly put the number right next to it if you wanted that exact use, that exactitude that he's craving. Well, Jeff, a little while ago, maybe about 2-3 months ago, let me know about the seminal research on pre-attentive attributes. This is from 1984 by William Cleveland and Robert McGill, where they did an incredible study on all the pre-attentive attributes, length, width, positioning, area, comparing area of circles, comparing the arc and pie charts, and seeing what are people good at and what are people poor at. And pretty much, you know, the reason that you'll see the defaults in Tableau going to where they go on certain circumstances is based on this research. And Jeff sent this along with some other research, and it helped inform me as to, hey, I was trying to figure out how do I show error bars, and how do I show uncertainty in survey data? And reading the Cleveland McGill research, I came up with this approach to it, which is also based on some work that some other people had done. I said, this is a really good way to show it. But to my surprise and delight, when I was looking at bars versus pies versus bubble charts, etc., they really liked what they call a dot chart. And take a look at this thing. They said, this really works well for helping people do accurate and precise comparisons. Now, it's not a lollipop chart, but it sure looks like a lollipop chart. You know, you've got the dot plot that's there, but you have these little dots as guiding lines. And I'll explain in a moment. They also suggested this could be a really good solution for, well, how are you going to deal with a stacked bar chart? They don't like stacked bar charts, and I've always argued they're kind of like cubist pie charts. So here's a stacked bar chart where they have the total as a dot chart, or as a essentially a lollipop chart with the overall length, and then you have the separate components that make up the overall length. So to my kind of to my delight on this, realized that we were not in fact introducing something which was sending people down a bad path. It's people are fine with being able to make the exact comparisons. So, Jeff, you have any thoughts on this?
Yeah, if you could you jump back to Stephen Few's slide? I guess Steve takes issue with it with precision, that the bar has a clear end to it with the dot. Are you looking at the center of the dot or the end of the dot, and where does the value stop there? My simple solution to that is when you put a little data label next to it, it has all the precision that you need. He didn't like that argument, but I find it funny when we put an axis there, an x axis that has 9 data labels to give you an estimation of where 7 points are. That's just, it's kind of funny and contradictory there, that you could use your labels other areas of your chart that could give you much more precision in this case to tell you exactly where those dots are, and then I think you have a much better chart. So I don't find that as much of an issue. I think that the other advantage of this in my mind is when you have bars with lots of color, or any color, and you have a sea of bar charts, a whole page filled with bar charts, that can be a little much. And so it reduces ink, it makes it simple. And so you can really focus on where the labels are without having the bars take over the visual eye. So that's interesting.
Oh, so we're asking for that. By the way, we're recording this. You can get the citation. You can send us an email anytime that you want. We'll be happy to send you this information. I found it a tough read, but ridiculously worthwhile. So moving on a little bit, I want to talk.
Can I point out one other thing, Steve?
My apologies, Jeff.
One more slide. Just something to point out on here, a great technique that I don't know that we use a lot is, I don't know if anybody noticed the dual axis, the top, the Y axis on the top, they show percent, and the bottom axis on the X, I said Y axis, I'm sorry, X axis, the bottom X axis has the values. And so this is an interesting thing to me. It kind of shows your percent of where each one is, along with the actual values at the bottom. Think of, you know, sales or quantity of something. You can have both your quantity and your percent shown in that. And I really like how they did that there. That could be a technique that we could use somewhere else.
Jeff, just following with that, one of the things that I do when I show with my tips and tricks is that very often you'll have, what were the sales for region A, region B, region C, and then what's the percent of sales? Same thing. Instead of having an axis on top and an axis on bottom, I will put the numbers in the header. I will, with what Tableau calls the header, along the left side. So here I have A, B, C, D, and E, and next to A, I would have 1.9 and the 15%. So you can say, gee, if you want your numbers, they're right there, but if you don't want to declutter up your chart, you can have that as well, and you can totally lose both axes if you wanted to. But great point about showing, hey, we can show the percentage and the actual values at the same time. Pretty compelling way to do this. Jeff and I both give workshops on the big book of dashboards, and we call it Building World-Class Business Dashboards. And I was at with some great people down at USAID. And at the beginning of the workshop, USAID's in Washington, D.C., I tell people, please disagree with me. You know, if you think I'm doing something which is incorrect, poor advice, you don't see it the same way that I'm seeing it, you don't think it's as clear as it could be, don't feel that you have to be quiet or that somehow you'd be showing up the instructor. As I've learned working so closely with Jeff and Andy Cotgreave, and we do need to get Andy on one of these, it is they're saying, hey, I'm not seeing it the same way that you do. It leads to better stuff. And I want to show you an example of that, where I was so used to looking at a chart a certain way that I didn't realize other people would not see it that way. And they were confused by stuff. I thought it was completely clear. They were confused. And I realized, okay, I can see why you thought that way. So let me give you the scenario. We would give people explain to some things. Hey, how would you visualize this thing? Let me explain what it is. We asked people before a class what they thought about something and after a class what they thought about something. And before they took this course, 15% of people enjoyed being in nature. And after the class, 97% enjoyed being in nature. And before the class, 48% wanted to spend more time outdoors, and after, 98%. So how would you visualize this? What would work? And we went through a number of different ways of doing it. And here is a barbell chart, a dumbbell chart, a gap chart, or a connected dot plot. And I think this is a great way to show this. You may quibble with the size of the circles because they're adding imprecision, but this is a good way to show it. Now, these before after type of things, they often lend themselves to a slope chart. In this case, we're running into some problems with here it is before, here it is after, and it works very well because I can judge the length of everything that comes before and the length of everything that, well, I can't really see the length of everything that comes after because too many of these dots are on top of each other. So while this will often work, a slope graph, in this case, it's a little tough. And one of the choices I know Andy Cotgreave likes is a distributed slope graph. And I presented this. And one person in particular was thinking, I don't like that. I don't get it. And the next day she came back and said, oh, here's why I was having a problem with it. I wasn't looking at the difference between the 15 and the 97. I wasn't looking at these pieces that are here. I was instead looking at the overall area and shape of these things. And I was trying to compare how big is this this polygon with this polygon. She thought she was trying to compare the area of polygons and not this. And I hadn't looked at it that way, but I could realize how it could cause confusion. So ultimately realized, you know, as much as I like the area chart, I think this is a better way to present the data. Now, I know Jeff and I are in agreement that of the three things I showed you here, and there are other ways to do this as well, I prefer this one. But if you do want to do the distributed slope graph, this may cause some confusion. This probably won't. Jeff, you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, you're right. I agree that the dumbbell chart connected dot plot there is probably my favorite. If you were looking at something, you know, that is before and after a course is time, I guess. But if you were looking at maybe years, maybe the slope graph might show years better, going from, you know, 2017 to 2018. I do agree that the dots, you know, in many cases for me are overplotted. Just introducing, I probably would on the dot plot probably move my labels outside of the dot and make them smaller. I guess the topic here though is really on the area underneath those slope graphs, and that's something I see financial shows do all the time. They show stock prices of something and they color underneath a line. Instead of using a line chart, they use an area chart, and then they color underneath it, but they don't start the stock price at zero. They start at some arbitrary number, and then that even confuses it worse. So I agree with you here. I think showing the area here doesn't really add. It confuses things here, and I've seen that in other places. And I never really thought about it, but Liana came up with a new lollipop chart based on your connected dot plot. She thinks that the lollipop manufacturer should make a double-ended lollipop and two flavors. So Liana's going to start selling lollipops.
And when now we're all going in on this, and that's how the business began. And also Ivana from USAID is commenting that she was the person who, you know, said, hey, I'm not quite buying this. And thank you. You have now made the world a better place for distributed slope graphs, Ivana. So I want to discuss some things that delighted, and Jeff, I'm going to soon pass things over to you in a moment, but I got to attend one of my favorite conferences. It's an annual thing, and it's indirectly run by Tableau. It's called Tapestry, and it's a small conference, and it was in Miami this year, and it was hosted by Alberto Cairo at the University of Miami, and I literally bumped into this guy, Joey Jadarczyk. Hopefully, Joey, I am not mangling your last name. And, you know, I looked at, he was wearing his name tag, and I saw he was with Dark Horse Analytics. I went, oh, Dark Horse Analytics. Wow, I love the stuff that you do. Jeff showed me some of the stuff you did, particularly Dark Horse Analytics, the redesign of a pie chart. And Joey said, oh, yeah, I did that. It was really fun. I went, you did that? Holy crap. Hey, Cole, Robert Kosar, everybody, you got to meet this guy. He's the guy that did this. And if you're wondering, well, what do you mean the guy who did what? What are you talking about? I've got that queued up at the moment. Remove to improve the pie chart. Remove to improve the pie chart edition. So here's a 3D pie chart, and Joey suggests, let's remove the backgrounds and see what happens. Okay, and now let's remove the borders. Okay. Let's remove the redundant legend. Okay, let's remove the 3D. Let's remove the bolding. Okay, it's looking a lot clearer. Let's reduce the colors. Let's remove the wedges. Thicken the lines. Emphasize the bacon. Good idea. And this always gets a huge laugh in the workshops. Less is more effective, attractive, impactive, and so on. And as someone who is among the pie chart haters, I just love this. And Robert Kosar and Cole were quick to point out, well, are you really making a fair comparison? Because with the bar chart, you're trying to compare the elements, which is bigger than the others, and sort them. And a pie chart is supposed to show the part-to-whole relationship. And I knew that, and I felt kind of silly saying, isn't this the greatest thing since sliced bread? But it had me thinking, well, is there a way to get both of these things to work really well together? And so I want to show you some stuff from the Big Book of Dashboards. Jeff has a chapter in there about what happens if your colleagues, your bosses, your clients insist that you use pie charts, and you have this awful screaming cat of a visualization where you've got a pie chart with 17 segments. And Jeff does a great job here, which is, hey, let me show you the part-to-whole relationship of the largest segment of phones. But then let me do you the accurate comparison of the 17 segments. So these things working together works very nicely. Now, humans are really good at a pie with two slices. And if I were to show you a pie, you know, that's like 27% versus 73%, I can just show you that without the number, and you'd see it's a little more than one quarter. Now, there are certain issues with it, though. We're really only good at this if you start at zero and go counterclockwise. Like, I can see this is 25%. Most people could not see this middle one is 25%. And people are going to have a very hard time with this, knowing, well, how big is that? It defeats the purpose. So you need to start this way, and you really can't have too many segments. But around the same time, Tableau had introduced set actions and realized, hey, I can create a composite of these two things, put them together, and put something that I think is pretty worthwhile here. So I've got this working here where I can select however many bars that I want and see these selected bars, how much of the whole do they make up? So I can take this and this, and I can see, oh, whatever these selections are, they're making up. And I can see without even seeing the numbers over here, it's super easy for me to see this is a little more than one quarter. And it works with the pig meat preferences as well. If I want to see, you know, ham and other together, I can see, okay, it's not quite making half. So it was a thrill to meet Joey, and it was really fun to create an interactive, adaptive version of what Jeff had in the Big Book of Dashboards, saying, hey, here's a good redesign of a pie chart. Have the pie two segments, but here's your bar chart. So, Jeff, any thoughts on that?
I don't. I use the Dark Horse Analytics little animated charts. I use those in my class all the time, and students and workshop attendees love that. It's just a great way to show the steps of those redesigns.
Yep. Well, and you were the one who first showed it to me, so thank you, Jeff. So, if you want to look this up, bars and pies living in harmony. Here's something else that excited me. We will get people in the workshops asking, how can I have a ton of different, I get so much pressure to put a lot of stuff on my dashboard. How can I have lots and lots of stuff on my dashboard? And the one technique is, instead of looking at it as, right now I'm seeing there are 24 elements here, and I can't help but see this as there are three rows of orange things and three squares of blue things. But I can change the way you perceive this by taking advantage of Gestalt theory or uniform connectedness, where you see the whole before you see the individual parts. I've just forced you to see three major elements here. And it works extremely effectively in dashboard design. And thinking about how nicely this works, there's some great dashboards in the book that were done by Dundas Analytics that use this very effectively. So I came across some stuff from one of my favorite data visualization guys. This is Roddy Zakovich. And he had published Marvel vs. Marvel. How do all these different Marvel movies can stack up against each other in terms of domestic gross and Rotten Tomatoes rating? So that's what this visualization was about. That's not the thing that got me all excited. It was, I just loved the use of the gray backgrounds here to say, okay, I want this to be taken together. I want this chart. There are two charts here, but I want this to be taken together. I want this to be taken together, and I want these two charts to be taken together. We could, Jeff and I could talk 15 minutes. Hey, should he be using colors to highlight these things? Is this the best form of jitter? Don't know, but I just loved what he had done with containers within the containers to make this happen. And I don't know when I saw it. I think it was Pooja Gandhi's and Adam Crayon's presentation at the Tableau conference. They were saying that dashboard padding can be your friend. And Roddy had done something a while back as well, which is container fun. And there are a lot of elements in this dashboard. I think there are 12, but you can't help but seeing three major things in terms of charts and then the filters along the left side. So Jeff and I would often have disagreements about using borders and things like that and putting boxes around stuff. But I think we both like the subtle use of the shading here to create these different areas. And Jeff, do we want to talk about music chops now or a little bit later?
Yeah, let's do the name the viz first, and then we can talk about that maybe.
Okay, so Jeff, I think this got you thinking about so hold on a second, let me see if I can go to stop sharing, and Jeff, I'm going to let you take over at this point.
Sure.
But I do want to discuss as you're getting this set up. Roddy has ridiculous data visualization chops, but he knows when and where to use it effectively.
I guess just on the concept of borders, I thought we would play a little game with Steve, and the participants can play along. I guess Steve, you should exit your chat window, so, or just click on participants or something, so you can't see their answers. But I'm going to show Steve some visualizations. mostly from the Tableau community and other dashboards. And we're going to see if Steve can name who that Viz author is. So for our first one here, I'm going to show Steve this one.
Okay. Hey, I got to confess, okay? I'm going to be totally, you know, Jeff and I did a little dress rehearsal, though I know you're throwing in a couple that I've never seen before. And I will, you know, fess to the ones that I didn't know. I did get this one correct. So I guess that this is either Bridget Coghlan or Kelly Martin. And Bridget, I know is a good close friend and colleague of Kelly's, and it just has a certain look and feel to it that just reminds me so much of their work.
Yeah, so this is Kelly Martin. Her website's Viz Candy. I pulled this one up just looking at the elements again. 9 different charts on here, and Kelly uses a very subtle approach. This dashboard's from a long time back. This dashboard's probably 4 or 5 years old now at this point, but she uses these rounded sort of containers, little cards to put the charts in. Does that separation very, very nicely with a really light gray border, almost even disappearing into the white background. Here's another one.
Okay. And I did get this one yesterday. This looks for something from Decisive Data, and specifically Jacob Alufska, if I'm getting the pronunciation correct. But I think I had seen some of their work. They do terrific work. They have a Data Plus Art, I think, is one of their books that's out. And I know they're also doing dashboard workshops as well.
Yeah, so he uses that same technique here, where it has these white chart areas on a little bit of a gray background to separate them. Also uses a border across the top, and that's a technique I see a lot. Now, in this case, that border is pretty thick up there, and it's orange, so it really does draw the eye. But I see that a lot. I Ann Jackson and I've seen Luke use that. I've seen Roddy use that. Here Jacob is using that. It's a good way to separate the filters, I see. The only thing I would challenge back on all this conversation about the borders is, you know, if you study a little bit about graphic design, you can do the same thing just with white space, with negative space on the page, and separating these areas with negative space without the borders. I think in the cases and the examples that we're showing here, it's done subtly, and so it works because it's subtle in nature. There, it's not real dark and black borders around all the charts and all of the elements. All right, here's another one. Steve didn't see this one yesterday.
Well, I'm going to take a guess. And I got to tell you, it's mostly because of the colors. And I'm going to go with Ryan Sleeper.
Everybody on the chat got it. And Steve got it. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that's Ryan. That's Ryan.
Yeah, he's...
You know, Ryan does the opposite here, right? He's got the little light border across the top to separate those filter windows. I like that better in this case. It's just light, but it separates the stuff at the top. Has a beautiful, the way he has descriptive separated from prescriptive versus the annotation at the top as well, and sort of that banner. Yet all the charts, they don't have borders around. Well, really, really light borders, right? Right. So almost like you can't even see them, and it gives it that separation. So that's another great example. All right, how about this one?
I did get this one the other day, and that is, and I wasn't certain, but that's Ann Jackson.
That's right. Yeah. And so in this one, Ann uses color boxes at the top. Now green is good, orange is bad. This is customer support tickets. So in the instance where it's down, that's a good thing. And when it's up, it's a bad thing. So number of customers up there is orange. I do like this technique. She actually has done some consulting for me as well, and we have some dashboards in our business that have this technique. The only concern I have with this is I think it can go too far. You know, there's so much color drawn to those boxes with the eye, especially when things are good and not bad. I'm kind of looking at everything, and so I feel like that can easily go too far. I'll give an example. Let me jump ahead here to this one. This is an example where, you know, there's just so much going on here that, you know, I have 6, 7, 8, 9 tiles that are all good, yet the green is drawing my eye over there. And this is a separate conversation for green and red color blindness. But, you know, the green is going to draw my eye over to all of those things that are good when I really only need to see a few things on this dashboard that are bad.
Jeff, can you stay on that one for a second? Because this is, we had something like that last time and realized that if you were to just make everything green, a muted gray, I think it would be much more effective. It would have me focusing on the three things that are really bad and the one thing which is semi-bad, and then I'm just not going to worry about anything else.
Yeah. All right. This is from our book of big book of dashboards, just showing you the same technique without the color, using the color on the font, right, as opposed to the block being colored.
Excellent.
So $16, you know, is bad. You know, it's up over year to date, but it's bad versus the other two numbers, churn, which are good. This is designed by Dundas and their software, Dundas software. All right. How about that one, Steve?
I got this one wrong.
No, you didn't see this one actually.
You didn't see this one yesterday. Oh, I didn't see this one yesterday. Oh, okay. Sorry. You know, I just can't help. I see a dark background and I'm thinking of, you know, the incredible brain trust from Pluralsight, you know, either Curtis Harris or Adam Crayon or Pooja Gandhi. So that's would be my guess.
That's a good guess. This is actually not them. I knew I'd throw you for a loop on that, grabbing one that's a dark background. This is actually Bridget. This is an example of where all of the stuff is separated with just negative space. The bands at the top have a line across the top. The separation of the chart elements, the left side of the dashboard versus the right side of the dashboard. I think this is an example, you know, of being able to put the filters at the top, the bands across the top, the charts separated just with negative space. And all right. How about last one?
You know, I know the answer to this one, and my guess was, I'm going to guess, you know, someone in the, actually, I got this wrong, that I thought it might have been someone from Spotify. So it might have been Peter Jilks, it might have been Skylar, it might have been Jacob, and I should have gone with my initial hunch, which was, hey, it's a dark background. That means it's probably from, and you can let people know, Jeff.
Yeah, this is Pooja. Pooja and the Pluralsight folks like to do a lot of stuff on a background. And if you look at Pooja's Tableau public profile, you see a lot of designs in this way. This has a lot of different elements, right? It has a black border around the stuff on the left. It has a gray, light gray chart areas with black borders around the titles. And so that's you know, really kind of interesting in the way this one is designed. I thought I'd play with this one, Steve. Not that I think this is bad in any way, but I just wanted to see what it would look like if I reduced some of that. And so just a, you know, little exercise here. If I take the black borders off the titles, that's what that looks like. And if I go even further, remove the black area on the left and remove the left on the left side and remove the gray on the right side where all of those charts are, I came up with that. And to me, this flows better. We're not talking about anything that's best practice at this point. I'm just talking about probably preference more than anything else. I love Pooja's design and I thought it was a beautiful viz, but the flow of it for me, this flows better with my three lines now and my columns. The grid design sort of pops out a little better for me. Acousticness kind of flows together with tempo and energy now, versus being separated from before. So just reducing some things there. in all of these examples today, I think all of these visualizations work because all of these designers did it with subtlety. What I see with my students when they do borders around charts and use all these techniques, it's too stark. They do it with big, thick black borders on a white background, separating these things with just too much. And I think the reason why all of these visualizations sort of worked is just because they all in every case we showed today, they all did it with great subtlety.
By the way, this is a place where you and I disagree, and it's a matter of taste. It's not right or wrong. I tend to like the borders or the shading, I think, more than you do. I think you're one of the best naturalists that I know. You will get it by using negative or using white space to have the elements that. Kind of like the amount of space before a paragraph or before a heading or after a heading. You're not using shading and things like that. These are things that say, oh, these things go together just by how close or far away they are from each other. I kind of like this item that's in between. And you know, you and I could be quibbling, minor things. Pooja does ridiculously great work. You know, I'm wondering, gee, do you need to have two good goodbyes on the thing twice? It's up at the top with the where you can hit the play button, and it's this big card that's over on the left. And yes, you have the 3.4 minutes of duration, and maybe put it on top of that other thing. So you're now somewhere in between, because if you go back to the original, you'd have the headings of a dance. Yeah, I kind of like the one that's in between, but that's just personal taste as opposed to the dashboard artist. I would have zero problem with your version of it, and I have no problem with Pooja's version of this thing. One thing I did want to comment on is, you know, some of the dashboards from Kelly. She's doing stuff that was from 6 years ago, and it's just, it was hard to make stuff like that in Tableau at the time. Not that it's easy to, you know, make something that beautiful now, but just really, really great use of color and shading and layout and grid, you know, stuff that I'm just not nearly as good at. And a huge admirer of the people who make these things that are analytically spot on, but are also beautiful. That you just want to spend time in the dashboard. Just some great stuff with it.
So the last topic I wanted to talk about before I pass it back to you, Steve, is Sankey diagrams. Chris Love has a blog post on that recently talking about Sankey diagrams. If you watch the analytics webcast with Ann Jackson and Luke Stanky, they had Chris on as a guest here kicking off the new year. And Sankey's diagrams came up. I think, you know, you could have picked any number of different charts to have that discussion, but they were talking about Sankey specifically. And I wanted to talk about that a little bit. For better or for worse, I guess I'm to blame for kicking that off in the Tableau world, coming up with a way of making those curvy lines. Joe Mako and Noah were doing, you know, Bezier curves, you know, long before that, but applying a sigmoid function in the Tableau space. I created this back in 2004. It was a chart that I think Andy Kriebel ran across on Twitter. I saw it and said, hey, maybe I could recreate that in Tableau, and I did, using a sigmoid function. And This isn't at the time a Sankey, right? It's really just a slope graph with curvy lines. I called it a Sankey style slope graph because it has weighted lines for the movement of the ranking. If it moves a lot, it's got a thick line. If it moves a little, it has a thin line. It really just acts like a slope graph. And so there were variations of that. I did this one to connect the years together, a slope graph going from there. Then people saw this technique and said, hey, can we make a Sankey diagram? I did one with my energy. And interesting enough, this chart here, I think, is how we formed a relationship. You saw this and you did a blog post on Sankeys, and you actually reached out to me after seeing this.
Also your quantified self, where you had, you know, you had a Sankey in there with the trumpet making playing music, which I enjoyed. So, you know, I just love that visualization.
And then there was a question on the forums after they saw my post. Hey, can we make something like this? And I responded, yes, we can. It's just a lot of different lines. The technique I used, you know, has gotten so much better. Chris Love and Olivier Catherine did a whole bunch of work with Olivier did it with polygons and did a great technique, so you didn't have to have all individual lines. And Chris did it with a different technique with data densification and introducing other things. And this kind of took off, right? In the Tableau world, you know, we see lots and lots of people doing lots of things. And for the most part, I agree with the dialogue that Chris has had lately about the overuse of them or maybe using them in the wrong sense. I thought I'd take a little flip on that and show you where I think sand keys really work. And not to get nitpicky about all this, we've come to call this a sand key. I guess probably more appropriately, it's an alluvial diagram. Sand keys were kind of something different, but we've all come to call this a sand key diagram. This is energy flow. It's showing energy moving. This is they have a diagram in this paper on winter season versus summer, how we're losing heat in the winter, how we're losing cool in the summer, where we're going, for example, from steam generated over here on the left, and we lose heat in the heat exchanger, we lose heat in the humidifier, we lose heat in the coils, and over here, you know, it results in heat lost from windows and walls and roofs and floors. And it's multi-step, right? We go through from step to step through the flow. Another one I've seen is Google Analytics. They have sort of a modified sand key here. It's a little different from what you just saw, but if you used Google Analytics for a long time, back in the day, they used to use funnel charts for this, and it was really a terrible visualization. And this is so much better for me. I can click on any one of my blog posts or any one of my starting pages. I can see how people move through the site from page to page. The red area there where it drops off and where people are dropping off, and I can kind of see that. And then one that I see the most, where I get the most emails, and probably the best use case of a sand key is in higher education. I get a lot of universities that have emailed me still. I mean, every year. It's kind of funny. If you look back here on my Google Analytics page, sand key is like still the second to highest blog post out there. I really hope someday that the convert Tableau will go away with all our new conversion opportunities in Tableau. So that'll eventually die off. But sand keys are still one of the most popular things. And where I get the most interest is universities that want to show the flow of students going from year to year, term one to term two to term three. They start with a major. In this case, the green area here is university college. That's where most of the students come in. We have some that drop out after the second term. Most of them stay in the university college, but then there's this big chunk down here that change majors and move over to the arts and sciences college. And then in the second year, same thing happens. The university college, we have a flow that drops down and ends up in arts and sciences. And then again in the last term, and we see it again. And so arts and science, you know, at the end ends up with all of these people that at the beginning started in university college. And so I think this is just a really good way of showing flow through a system. We see it misused a lot, but I struggle to think about how else you would visualize this. A series of bar charts is not going to work here. Line charts and bar charts and dot plots are not going to show your flow through the system. The other thing I would add to this is it really works best with interactivity, being able to click on a flow and then identifying that flow as it goes on. That's a beauty about people trying to build that in Tableau. Tableau has that natural interactivity where you can add a filter, add a state, add any kind of dimension, right? And you can filter and it automatically works with your visualization. A lot of people build this, you know, in D3, requires a lot of coding to do something like this, but that gives it interactivity that you know, makes it easier to use. So I just thought I would point out a couple of those examples. Somebody posted it doesn't work in the undergraduate movement because they move a lot and there's more than 20 measures. They find it works best with less than 20. And I would agree with that. Somebody, believe it or not, I had one email me where they had 3,000 different dimensions that they were doing. And it's just not going to work when you have, you know, 3,000 flows, right? You're going to have to filter it down in some way. So maybe in the undergraduate, maybe it's you start with colleges and see the movement by college and look at the majors within a college or something. The filters across the top in this case might happen. So that's my thoughts on that. I turn it over to you, Steve.
Yeah, I want to, well, keep this up there for a second. You may recall we were working for a while to get a SAN key into the big book of dashboards, and the particular use case that we had just didn't work particularly well. I think this would work well. The issue in the discussion is this is a good use for this. This example, I don't think I can do better with it or come up with something. The only thing I'd like to augment with it is I'd love to have some bar charts, marginal bar charts, showing me, well, just how much bigger on the left side is UC, then EN, then AS on the left side, and then on the right side, so that I can compare how much bigger is stop than UC, than MG, et cetera. So that, right now they're kind of floating there, they're stacked bars, and I can't see have that common thing. So I'd like to have two little helper charts to add to this. I think the concern is, oh, people just love this curvy stuff, and they desperately want to put curvy stuff into their own work because it looks cool and it's inviting. And this kind of gets back to my admiration of Roddy Zakovich and Adam McCann and Christy Martini and others, who they can make insanely great curvy stuff, but they use it when it's appropriate. You know, some of the Roddy has ridiculous, as if we were to teach, you and I often speak in musical metaphors. Both of us have master's degrees in music. He has ridiculous chops. You know, he can play up and down the neck, 64th notes, going all over the place and playing like crazy. And just because he can doesn't mean that you should. And what I like so much about his work is sometimes he'll create a super simple chart. And as opposed to, well, let me impress people with making ridiculously curvy stuff going on. So hats off to those who have the discretion. Just because you have great chops doesn't mean it's appropriate to use them.
That might be a good place where we're running into the end. And I have a short video that I'll share as we close, maybe just to talk about the chops there. We'll take questions in the chat window. And Steve and I have scheduled our next chart chat presentation, which we'll share with you in for February.
Jeff, I think I promised a couple of people the population pyramid. I'll only spend a minute on it, but why don't you do the video first?
Yeah, so what I'm going to show you here is just a quick video of it's an excerpt of Bach's Brandenburg Concerto number 5, and it's going to that musical reference talking about chops. You're going to hear a harpsichord player who would normally just be playing chords, and maybe in the opera world they're playing behind a recitative. They don't play very much; they'll play chords here and there. And in this particular Brandenburg Concerto, they're playing quite a bit. All of a sudden, it goes from playing chords to this amazing thing that probably most people wouldn't be able to play. And so I thought I would just share that with you and kind of talk about that just for a second here. So here's that. Johann Sebastian Bach, Brandenburg Concerto number 5, just a quick excerpt. The bottom two lines are the harpsichord player. Couple people have said it's freezing on the screen, so I we'll post a link to that to share it. But I think the point there was that it's done in taste. You know, you have somebody who has amazing chops, who can create something in Tableau that will blow you away, yet they reserve it for when they think it's needed and done in sort of a subtle way. So,
and that was fun. I hadn't seen that before. So let me just do this quickly. So if we're going to follow our first chart chat, we discussed things that delighted us and things that, maybe didn't delight us so much. And here was something that came from a World Economic Forum and how to be a leader in the fourth industrial revolution, and in particular this chart, which is from the Global Gender Gap Index and the World Economic Forum. This report is amazing, and there are some great charts in this, but this was not one of the great charts. And they want to really highlight the gender gap that's there. And it's super easy for me to compare the things on the left side with each other and the things on the right side with each other, but it's really hard for me to compare the left side with the right side. Jeff, pop quiz really fast. Where is the biggest gap between men and women?
Sorry, my mic is off. I have to go into mental math doing real quick equations left to right. I think I got it right yesterday. It's education, I think, with 17 minus 10 maybe is 7% gap.
No. Largest gap would be, well, it becomes, you know, and if I would ask people a whole bunch of questions about this and saying, where's the largest gap, where's the smallest gap, things like that, it's hard. If I instead say, you know, as attractive as this is, it's much easier to do it right here. I'm sorting from the, for one thing, I'm sorting from the most popular field to the least popular field. And, oh, I can't help but see, look how wide that line is in there. It's the third thing from the top, engineering, manufacturing, and construction. And Jeff, if I were to ask you, what is the second?
I got that right yesterday and got it wrong today. So that's how bad it is.
And you got it totally right today. And the, hey, what's the second most? What's the second largest gap?
I'm going to go education, I guess.
Yeah, it's tied, by the way.
Tied with health and welfare.
Yeah, and you can see, hey, the thing at the bottom, they're completely tied. And the thing at top, where the most popular field, it's the gap is very narrow. So this is a possible way to do it. Here's another way to do it, which would be the distributed slope chart. I prefer the other way, but I think this way is fine. And this is from the most popular to the least popular. But again, the same thing screams out. I can see, wow, there's a really big gap here between men and women in engineering, manufacturing, construction. And you do not get that easily with the population pyramid. So that's why I wanted to show people that. Yeah, Jeff, you mentioned, so a couple things. I love the stuff from Pew Research. And next time we're going to show some of the amazing stuff that they did, but showing the difference between Democrats and Republicans and the gap. If you were to put all the Democrats on the left and all the Republicans on the right, you'd run into the same problem. So we will come back to that. We didn't have time to do critique in data viz or something that I have brewing, which is the cost of a large amplifier. Those of us that who a lot of people follow or listening to, and the importance of, gee, if you're going to post something or a technique or an idea, just realize that a lot of people may start emulating it, and some of the concerns with that. Very quickly, and thank you all for hanging a little bit. We went slightly over. Resources, workshops, and upcoming classes. A lot of the dashboards that we have in the big book of dashboards. The recording of Chart Chat, which will be available soon, you will find at bigbookofdashboards.com. And I'm just plugging, I have a workshop in Miami on January 22nd, and I have a visualizing survey data class, online class, January 15th and 17th. And looks like Chart Chat has been quite successful. So Jeff, are we aiming for February 19th?
February 19th it is.
All right. So, Jeff, if you want, we can turn the recorder off.
We'll have all the links in the videos posted. My website is dataplusscience.com.
Great stuff there, by the way. And great resources, great blogs. Sincerely think that you should follow him. Andrea, thank you so much. Jeff, shall we take some questions, maybe turn the recorder off, or just keep this going for a while? What do you think?
Happy to do that. I'll shut the recording down. Thank you, everybody, and see you next time.